Dutch Consulate in Antwerpen, the Netherlands Enterprise Agency, and the Ministry of Infrastructure and Water Management. At Holland Circular Hotspot, we want to make circular economy happen at the international level. We do that by sharing best practices from business. We share tools, insights, and facts and figures from knowledge institutes. And we share all of those hard-learned lessons from our government, over 150 years of waste management, incentive, regulation, etc. What we hope, of course, is that we can make this world a better place, work on the societal goals, work on the climate targets, and create mutual business opportunities. Now, as Holland Circular Hotspot, we do that as a team, and at least half the team is working behind the screens to facilitate your questions, to prepare that we have a smooth transition. I think it goes a little bit too fast. Today we will be talking about packaging. As you know, plastics, to mention one very dominant material, is a fantastic material. It changed the world. It's functional, it's aesthetic, it increased hygiene, yet plastics have a serious waste issue. It's 32% is leaking, 40% is landfilling, 40% incinerated, only 2% is truly, truly circular. And plastics, it really reached the living room. People are concerned about, they can identify with packaging, for instance, and that's 40% of all plastics. They can identify with litter. They are worried about substances of very high concern. They are worried about microfibers. Now, the negative impact is actually overshadowing the very good properties of plastics. Now, should we ban a material that is fantastic, or can we also design a way to the future? Now, international action is booming as we speak, and the speakers will highlight this as well. China closed its border, and that actually could be a blessing in disguise, because it means we have to clean up our own mess and valorize our own waste. There are exciting, really exciting developments in, for instance, bioplastics. There are exciting developments in chemical recycling. Could that be the scale-up we need for the market? And our speakers will talk about it all. Now, today, the Netherlands and Belgium, I think they are both front runners in the game. We will focus on packaging because it's 40% of all plastics. And we also talk about design, because 80% of the environmental footprint of a product can be determined in the design phase. We hope to learn from each other, from Belgium and the Netherlands, and to learn how we can team up and make a change. We have a fantastic program, as you can see on the screen. We'll very soon start with an introduction by the interim ambassador of the Netherlands in Belgium, Kasper Veldkamp. We'll have the overview presentation from Carl Franken from Vito, regulatory context, trend in design, technology and market. And that's countered by the same overview of Esther Zonder van den Beuken from TNO. Both speakers will add another aspect as well. Carl Franken will focus a little bit more on bio-based plastics, and Esther will focus a little bit more on chemical recycling. Then we move to business, because that's where it's happening. That's where the scaling up has to come from. Philip van Geel from Valipak will share circular packaging in motion, and Vincent Mooy, head of Suez Circpack, will share cross-border business experiences from the back of the value chain to the front. And then we'll confront all these ideas, these insights, and we'll have a panel. But without further ado, I would love to give the floor to Kasper Veldkamp, the interim ambassador of the Embassy of the Kingdom of the Netherlands in Belgium. Kasper, the floor is yours. Do we have Kasper in our middle in the meantime? Can we unmute Kasper? We're looking through the screen. We're looking if we can find Kasper Veldkamp. Please bear with us a second. M- Maybe a quick question to the embassy, Ariane. Is there any intel on Kasper Veldkamp? Otherwise, we move with the first speaker.
For now, I'm not seeing him between the people. I'll come back to you as soon as possible when I know what's going on.
Okay, then we'll continue with the program. We will continue with the first speaker. And the first speaker is Carl Franken, Research Manager Sustainable Materials from Vito. Carl, can I invite you to take the lead?
Yes, okay. Thank you, Freek, and good morning, everyone. I'm very happy to be here and to see that there are so many participants to this hopefully interesting webinar. And if everything's fine, you're now able to see my screen. Can you please confirm that?
We do not see your screen yet, Carl. Can you try again? Yes.
Yes? No, it says here that I'm sharing. Is that okay?
Please, go ahead.
Okay, so my name is Karel Franken. I'm a research manager for sustainable materials at Vito. Vito is a research institute based in Belgium, and here you have some basic numbers about us. The left side shows all the different topics that we're working in. The right side shows some numbers. So we're about 1,000 employees with an overall turnover of 200 million euros per year. And if you want to learn more about this, please visit our website and our annual report. What I want to talk about is about packaging. That was a topic of today, and I would like to talk about it from a circular perspective and focus on bio-based materials and look a bit at how this is dealt with in Belgium, but also from a European perspective. I come from Antwerp, and this is a picture that was taken somewhere in a street in Antwerp, and it's sort of a good representation of what I would call circular hell. It's a shop which is only focused on selling throwaway goods, throwaway packaging goods. So rather than explaining what circular economy is, maybe we can just share the idea that this is what we don't like to see anymore in the future. Well, the question is, how do we get there? And what it is that we are doing in order to reach that goal? So this is an example of work that we are doing at the European level for the European Environment Agency. We've done a lot of work on plastic in general, packaging more specifically. And one of the main guiding issues, as already mentioned by Freek here, is indeed the plastic exports, which have been reduced. And you can see in this picture at European level how the plastic trades changed from going mainly to China, the blue here, to other countries, and where China has really been reduced. You can find these data on the EEA, European Environment Agency website. So this sort of paints the picture. There's a strong pressure on Europe, on Belgium, on the Netherlands to start managing their own waste and to look at a different way of approaching the waste. And of course, the circular economy can guide in that perspective. I'm sure most of you have seen this graph before, the butterfly diagram initially proposed by the Ellen MacArthur Foundation. And I like to show it again, because of course it's always interesting to repeat that recycling is not the only thing in the circular economy. There's more. Recycling is sort of the last option, and we want to refurbish, reuse, repair. But what's also often forgotten is that there's a left side to the butterfly diagram as well, which looks at the biological cycle, and where we think or suggest that biological materials can be biochemical feedstock for the industry, and that there's this sort of cascading approach where we also want to look at how we treat the material in various steps and try to make the bring the biological material back into the biological cycle through a digestion stage and a composting stage where it can be fertilizing material again for new natural material. And that's so that's a bio perspective is sort of the perspective that I want to take you with today. This idea of connecting the bioeconomy to the circular economy and the need to do that more was reflected in a report that we launched 1.5 years ago for the European Environment Agency. It's part of a series of reports on the circular economy, And so this is one that I will be taking some results out of now, circular economy and the bioeconomy, which can be found online as well. Important, of course, when we talk about bioeconomy and bioplastics is again to reiterate that there's different types of bioplastics and that bio-based material is not identical to biodegradable material. And this is shown very well in this graph, which is proposed by the European Bioplastics Organization. So we see that there's a difference between non-biodegradable plastics based on biological precursors, which can even be PE, PET, but then bio-based. There's bioplastics, which are bio-based and biodegradable. And there's also fossil-based biodegradable plastics, which is an element which is often forgotten. And that is then opposed to the non-biodegradable fossil-based plastics, the one that we typically think of when we say plastics. What's important to note is that these biomaterials, they are not per se better for the environment. They are not per se circular. So when we look at this bioeconomy and the circular economy, it's important to realize that greenhouse gas benefits of the bio-based products will depend on production practices, lifetimes, and end-of-life treatment also for these sort of materials. The using bio-based material is not sort of a free ride or an opportunity to just make any material you want and to start using big amounts of materials. And there's, from that perspective, a need for more synergy between bioeconomy and circular economy, looking at collaboration among the value chain, looking at infrastructure design. And so I want to see a bit how this then goes for packaging material as well. Because packaging materials are very important if you look at bioplastics. Overall, bioplastics are only 1% of the full plastic chain with a biopolymer production capacity. These are data for 2019, 21. So 6.6 million ton, growing to 8.5 million ton in 2021, which is a relatively limited capacity. And it's important to realize that only 20% of those bioplastics are biodegradable at the moment. And you see that the main application area of the bioplastics that are produced, so of these around 7 billion tons, they are applied mainly in packaging materials. And when we look at the Belgian or the Flemish policy at the moment, an important policy element is the plastics plan, an action plan on plastics that was just recently formulated and presented by OVAM, the Flemish Waste Authority. And I've chosen to mainly focus on this document. There's a variety of legislation, but it's good, I think, to have a little bit of focus. So I chose to focus a bit on the action plan for plastics that was just proposed. And this says, interestingly, that composting of compostable plastics has no added value for compost. If we compost compostable biodegradable plastics, the material is turned into CO2 and water for more than or for around 90%. And this sort of justifies the fact that the Flemish Authority choose to limit biodegradable and compostable plastics. Yeah? They see it as a solution for fruit stickers, for tea bags, for coffee pads, for tomato clips, for those plastic streams that are very difficult to separate out of the green waste stream or the food waste stream. And there we see those biodegradable plastics and compostable plastics as a good solution because inherently they will go with the food material flow. We have a very strong separate collection system that has been developed over the past years in Flanders and that is very much adhered to and it's also seen as an example separate collection system in Europe. So if we then look at how those bio materials, the bio-based packaging materials can go into this chain, these are the sorting instructions. And they are based on this idea that if you have biodegradable materials, that probably if you bring them to an industrial digestion and composting plant, that they will not degrade under those conditions. And on the other hand, it's also necessary, yeah, to really collect those materials. And you cannot just throw them in nature, because also there they will, of course, not biodegrade. If we then look at the existing packaging materials, there is a problem with their complementarity with the recycling system of the petro-based plastics. And so that is what we see here in the typically the blue bag, what we call the PMD bag. We collect plastic materials and we give advice to the households that they can sort bio-based plastic materials like PET, PPPS in the blue bag. But biodegradable and compostable materials like PLAs, they are not allowed to go into the plastic bag. So they cannot be sorted in the normal plastic system. That's because the PLA cannot be recognized separately from the PET, for instance. And so it's gives a problem in the sorting of PET for the current, that is for the current existing system, of course. On the other hand, it's also not allowed to sort these materials in the composting fraction, because they don't compost in the, some they don't compost if they're just biodegradable in the industrial installations. And even if they have an okay compost label, we think that they don't really contribute. So there we prefer that their applications are limited, really limited to the collection bags, or as said before, those tomato clips and the labels. And of course, it's very clear that biodegradable materials cannot just be littered in nature. So what are some bottlenecks there for bioplastics in packaging? It is that the proper collection and sorting of, for instance, PLA poses problems in closing material loops. And so basically we need to say that also for those materials, recycling is the preferable option. We don't see composting there as a preferable option, because basically we don't contribute. It's just processing the material to CO2 and water. So the CO2 in the end is released anyway, although that it's from a renewable source. So recycling is the preferable option also for biodegradable plastics. And it is necessary there to look into and to develop catalytic chemical recycling routes. And the next speaker will also go into more detail about chemical recycling and the role of catalytic chemical recycling in that perspective. Okay, so that's the main issues for biodegradable. If I look further into this overall strategy and the master plan for plastics, I just wanted to highlight a few other actions, because they very clearly state what are the current problems. Maybe we want to make sure that recycling can be done in Belgium. We want to stimulate the market for recycled plastic granulates, something which is a very, very strong problem at this moment, because there's really a heaping up of those materials because the market has slowed down. We think that there's a need for a harmonized system for recycled content at European level. And we will implement the ban on the use of single-use catering materials for all Flemish administration and local government. This is an important action. It goes further than just banning of plastic bags in the shops. Yes, so there is the idea, the plan, the action in this strategic plan to implement a ban on the use of single-use catering materials for all Flemish administration. And that brings us back to this shop that I showed you in the beginning. So this will no longer exist, at least for Flemish administration and local government. So to come to conclusions, I want to say that it's overall important for both petro-based and bio-based materials to reduce packaging, to look at solutions that use less packaging. And I've introduced here a picture of this sort of package-less shop, to reuse packaging materials. And there's good examples there. I just included one example still here, Repack, which is a system where you can send your packaging material back to the owner. It's important to collect the used material also for biodegradables. They will need a separate collection system or a specific collection system that allows the recycling of that material back into the chain. And I just wanted to state again that all those ideas, which we typically know, that they also apply for biodegradable materials. I thank you very much, and I invite you to come to another conference, yet another conference at the end of October, where we hope we can have a physical event. Thank you.
Thank you, Carl. Very much appreciated. Very clear overview. It's clear that we should not throw away biodegradable plastics. We need good collection. We need also larger local recycling capacity. We need to combine it with bans and work at the European level. very much try to share my screen again to welcome the ambassador of the Netherlands in Belgium, Casper Veldkom, for a word of welcome. Casper, the floor is yours.
Well, thank you, Freek, and also thank you, Carol, very much for the interesting introduction you had. June is a busy month, and I'm running from call to call. It's really as always busy, but it seems to be more busy now. We are after or slowly getting after the Corona crisis. This kind of event, this webinar, is typically the kind of thing that we as an embassy of the Netherlands in Belgium like to keep organizing in the situation. We've actually, as an embassy, never been closed. We're mostly working from home, but indeed sometimes working at the embassy. I'm currently there, as you see, the flags at the office. But we've mostly worked the past few months, of course, on the border situation. I'll spare you the details in facilitating as much as possible, for example, people in crucial professions and vital sectors to make it easy to cross the border. We've been working on Dutch tourists stranded in abroad in the Netherlands and Belgium, helping each other to bring them back to their countries. We've also been trying to continue as much as possible with economic activities, with several webinars, and this is one of those. Now, this is, of course, a very important topic. I think Holland Circle Hotspot for co-hosting this event. And of course, I should underline the importance of this topic. Sustainable production, supply change, I think we've become even more aware of their importance in the past few months, and the transition towards a circular economy is of course also a very important element in the Green Deal of the European Commission and its proposals in the plans for a post-corona economic recovery. Now, circular economy is of course very high on the agenda both in the Netherlands and in Belgium. And as you know, in the Netherlands and in Belgium, we have set quite high ambitions in this regard. The Netherlands hopes to be 50% circular by 2030 and 100% circular by 2050. Belgium hopes to become the most important leader in the EU in the field of circular economy by 2030, and its regions, as you already understood, have ambitious plans too. According to the last circularity gap report, the Dutch economy at this moment is 24.5% circular. That's something to be proud of when you compare to the world economy, which is 8.6% circular. But if we want to achieve, of course, the ambitious goals we've set for ourselves for 2030, we need partners to speed up the transition. And I believe the Netherlands and Belgium can help each other very much in this regard, in providing each other also with best practices, but also with business opportunities. A good example of the intensive cooperation between Netherlands and Belgium is, of course, also the launch of the European Plastics Pact this year on March 6th, just before the corona crisis really hit us. And this pact brings together governments and front runners from across the whole plastics value chain. And Belgium was one of the first member states to immediately sign this pact. I was also happy to see that at the launch on March 6th, that a number of Belgian companies were present at the signing in Brussels. Now, the coronavirus has been severely hit us in many ways, also in terms of economic impact. We're starting to see the economic forecast for 2020 fluctuate between a decline of 8 and 14% of GDP. Most economies predict a relatively slow recovery, but it's not all doom and gloom. There are plenty of opportunities and business opportunities too, also across the border, especially with products and services that contribute to a sustainable economy. I've noticed also in calls with managing directors and CEOs of Dutch companies present in Belgium that the economic impact of the corona crisis is unequal. It has not hit all sectors in the same way. I don't disclose any secrets when I say that food retail has been doing relatively well still, but non-food retail has been clearly hit. Restaurants and bars and so had an 88% decline in their business. Aviation sector, a strong decline. But in some sectors, including food retail, it stayed pretty much the same or sometimes even an increase or relatively limited slowdown compared to pre-crisis levels. And therefore, also the demand for packaging in the sector, of course, has remained. Now, on the circular economy, in order to support cross-border cooperation in this field, the Dutch Embassy in Brussels and our Consulate General in Antwerp will be facilitating a number of activities in the next few weeks and months. First, on construction and infrastructure. Second, on recycling of wind turbine blades. And third, of course, plastics and packaging. So I would advise all participants to keep an eye on our website or sign up to our newsletter to get the latest information. And furthermore, our embassy is also open for business, of course, when you have more specific trade and economic questions concerning doing business in Belgium and its regions. Our team of policy officers and trade attaches and experts will gladly help you to navigate cross-border trade between the Netherlands and Belgium. I look forward to the presentations of our interesting speakers today and on the discussion on how we can cooperate more on sustainable design in packaging. Thank you very much. And again, Freek, Holland Circular Hotspot, thank you very much for co-organizing this event.
Thank you, Casper. Thank you, Mr. Ambassador. Very much appreciated your words of welcome. For your information, we have 89 people who have registered for this event, 20 from Belgium, 50 from the Netherlands, but also people as far as Hong Kong, Vietnam, India, Canada, France, Turkey, Australia, and Russia. So it's definitely a topic which attracts interest.
Virtual globalization. Yeah.
I hope that the Netherlands and Belgium together can lead the way in our own area, but also inspire the rest of the world. We move on with our program. We move on to one of the leading institutes in the Netherlands, TL, Esther Zonder van Van den Beuken, for her introduction on the playing field in the Netherlands. Thank you. Esther, over to you.
Thank you, Freek. I will share my screen. Just a moment, please. So good morning, everybody. My name is Esther Sonnevan, working as a program manager at TNO in the field of circular plastics. And my presentation is about sustainable design for packaging in the Netherlands. And first, to show you some information about TNO, we are divided in 9 units working in different fields. And I'm working in the unit Circular Economy and Environment. And TNO is working with about 3,000 people nowadays. And within our unit, we closely work together also with other units like energy, like healthy living, and strategic analysis and policy. And what is important for TNO is that we connect the people and the knowledge to help also the industry to be innovative. So this is what we do in the field of circular plastic. And what we would like to do is that we would like to close the cycle of plastics. So starting from the production to the collection, to the recycling and making the granulate and reuse it in plastics. And then preferably if there's new plastics used, then we should use not the oil anymore, but the biomass. And working in this, connecting this cycle, there are a few things important where we work on at TNO, and that is on the value chain. So the total value chain should be connected to each other and know what they are doing and what are the critical steps for their production. And of course, we are working also on life cycle assessments, guiding the right choices, design for recycling, and we work on several recycling technologies, so mechanical recycling as well as chemical recycling. And here you see a nice overview of Plastic Europe about the life cycles of plastics in the Netherlands. It was published this year. And as you can see from the upper left, we produce quite a high amount of plastics. This is not all used in the Netherlands, but part of this is exported to other countries. The amount of packaging that we use is quite high in the Netherlands, so that is 600 kiloton about. And here you can see on the right side, you can see the amounts that that is that are collected. So when you're going, so we see that we are about 1,000 kilotons of plastics is collected. That is going to the sorting and the recycling. And here there is about 200 kilotons of plastic recyclate, which is applied in new products. And showing from packaging, this amount is still limited. And I think we can increase quite a lot in the coming year by having better recycling technologies and also improving our collection. And for that, I think we need a combination of mechanical recycling, what is nowadays mostly used, and also with chemical recycling. So we have to follow then, of course, the legislation, and I'm regarding the time, I'm not going into detail this legislation, but please be aware that there is legislation in place that you have to follow. And it is also good that there is a really incentive to come to a design for recycling, to better recycling methods, and those are collected in all type of initiatives that you can see here that are voluntary, but they are working quite hard to come to those targets. Then I would like to go a bit more into detail for the Dutch Plastic Pact, which was the European Plastic Pact was already mentioned, which was launched in March. Dutch Plastic Pact was launched in February 2019, already signed by 110 parties. And what is also good is that the government is also partner of this process. And here the goals of the Dutch Plastic Pact are mentioned. So what we would like is that we start with 100% recyclable plastics, that 70% of the single-use plastic products in packaging are recycled. Less use of plastics, 20% less use, and when and also we have ambitions for the amount of plastics of recycled material in those plastic packaging products that should be 35%, and these targets are set for 2025. Then I would like to share some nice trends in packaging. And what we see is that you see design for recycling or design for circularity. So there is a trend going to all polyolefin packaging and for instance, all PE or all PP. So you see here a product of Mondi for the soup packaging, which nowadays mostly is used in multi-layers, but can be now replaced by all polypropylene. There is also a nice example of the milk bottle from which is for which is based on bio-based polyethylene, and here it's important that it's not only the bottle which is good recyclable, but also the cap and the sleeve which is recyclable. And TNO worked also together with partners in an NWA project. And we work together with Flexoplast and Dow also on the applications of all PP and all PE. Another nice example is the cooperation of the value chain. So the back-to-back of those partners here, which uses 50% of the recyclate in the same product. And also the Sapia is a very nice example, which received also a packaging price for it, which consists of 100% of recyclate and which is also good recyclable. Here you can see some other trends in packaging. So this is the reusable bag for your groceries or for bread, and also a system, well, Carl already said, here you can take your own reusable packaging and collect what is needed. Another trend is what we see is that plastics is replaced by other materials. So the here for the beer cans, not having the plastic foil, but having paper, or here even better, the plastic of the aluminium cans that you can click on each other's. And also you see sometimes the replacement of the plastic bags by paper bags. But please be aware, well, actually the same as Carl already said, that bio-based is not always has a better overall environmental footprint. That can also be the case by switching from plastics to other materials, for instance, switching from plastic bags to paper bags. Then, having those designs, then we should have a system that we can recycle and recover our plastics in a very good good way. And there are several technologies for that. Starting from mono streams, which are quite clean, then you can go to mechanical recycling. Dissolution is a technology where you can remove your impurities and go back to the polymers. Then you have depolymerization, which is often used for nowadays for PET recycling. And then you have the thermochemical recycling of gasification and pyrolysis, in which you go to the basic sources of plastic, so the chemicals or to the naphtha. So these are the different types of recycling options that we can use. Then just a quick view about what is the state of the art for the different chemical recycling routes, or dissolution, which is also called more physical recycling. So that is already applied for PVC, PS, PP, PE. It's not at a very high level, so most are now in a pilot phase. And I would like to stress out two ones, polystyrene looped, which is used for EPS in Terneuzen, and also Obotech, who would like to build a new pilot plant for the separation of PE and PE materials and go back to a good quality virgin material. So then the chemical depolymerization, this can be used for polycondensation polymers for the chemist under us. So that is PET, PE, polycarbonate, polyurethane, and the bio-based plastic PLA as well. And in the Netherlands, I would like to stress that there are two companies, Cure, working on the PET, and Ionica as well. Working on those, and they are very promising. So here you see the that there is also quite a lot going on thermochemical recycling, and all kinds of initiatives are started. And you see that the big companies like SABIC, Dow, BASF, Shell, they all are included in the initiatives working on new pyrolysis plants for the thermochemical recycling of plastics, or to the gasification, which is the Inicam facility in Rotterdam. Well, as I already said in the beginning, what is important is that when we when we develop a product, or when we develop a technology, that we not be too narrow, look too narrow, but that we really look at the impact assessment to do the right choices. And Tino has there a tool for that we can determine what is the impact, and is the new technology or is the new product, is that better for than the other product. And here we did it by comparing, for instance, different technologies like incineration with energy recovery, that is the L1, and then mechanical recycling, 100% mechanical recycling and dissolution under superheated conditions. And here you see that the benefit becomes higher in this way. And this we can apply for all types of technologies as well as for products. And finally, I would like, this is my last slide, to show you also the PRISM model. So this is a model that we can determine how should we deal with certain types of waste. So then taking into account what are the different waste, what is the specific sector, what is the collection method, and what are then ways that we can treat those type of waste streams. And then for instance, when you go to house PE, household residual waste, then you see that you have a great benefit when going from incineration with energy recovery to mechanical recycling. So this is this gives a great benefit. And with this message, I would also to close my presentation, that we really have to have an overall strategic view how to do the how to deal with our waste streams. So thank you for your attention, and please feel free, if you need more information, to contact us after this webinar.
Thank you very much, Esther. Much appreciated. And as we can expect from TNO, we need a systematic approach to solve the questions between mechanical and chemical recycling. And from the examples you presented, I believe we need to work at it at the international level. So Belgian players, German players, Dutch players. So the European level is very important. Thank you again. Please stop sharing your screen. Then we prepare for our next speaker. And now businesses at world. I mean, whatever government is deciding in the direction, in the end, business has to show guts, invest, and show the way, and let's say, make the difference. Well, the first representative from the business side is Philip from Valipak. Philip, please explain what Valipak is and how we should look at the sustainable design of packaging.
Good morning from Wemmel, close to Brussels, Belgium. So my name is Philip Van Geer. I'm circular economy manager at Valipak. Can you all see my screen?
Yes, please put it on full screen.
But who's Valipak? You might ask yourself, but let me first go a little bit into the history. So in Europe, we had the Directive 94/62/EC that was established with the objectives to have less packaging waste and to make more environmental friendly and or reusable packaging. So this got transposed into Belgian law in 1997. And given that Belgium is a rather complex country with three regions, where every region has the right to put their own laws for waste management, the interregional cooperation agreement was established, which is then led by the Interregional Packaging Commission. With the clear question, who is responsible for packaging and what are the obligations of the packaging people responsible for packaging. So here were two companies, or two non-for-profit companies established. That's FOSPLUS and Valipak. FOSPLUS is responsible for everything which is household packaging, while Valipak is transport or commercial and industrial packaging waste. We are one of the few companies in Europe that is focusing only on commercial and industrial packaging waste. So we are an accredited organization for the extended producer responsibility for industrial packaging waste in Belgium, like I said. We are operational since 1998, and we were created by the Belgian industry for the Belgian industry. Like I said as well, we are a non-profit company, and the principles that we guide is a free market. We don't want to interfere in the commercial relationships between our members, the waste collectors, and of course their customers. It's non-discriminatory between members, waste collectors and their customers. So we don't do cherry picking. Everybody is welcome to join the system. It's a pool system. Incentives to stimulate the selective collection at source are handed out. It's multi-material and multi-sectorial. So everybody who wants to become a member can become a member. And we try to strive for a minimal cost system. So how does this work in practice? Well, we start with parties responsible for packaging. In Belgium, we have roughly 7,000 members, which we cover about 90% of the market. So these companies give us the number of packaging materials and ton that they put on the market, and they pay a fee for this. On the other hand, what we're going to collect from the waste management companies, we're going to record how much ton of packaging material they took off the Belgian market, so how much material they collected. There's 220 sites that are linked to our system that are affiliated to Valipak. So what does this mean? We have info A, so the material that's put on the market. We have info B, the quantity of recycled packaging waste that we get off the market. And the recycling target should be at least 80%. This is set by law. And when I say by law, of course, we have to report on an annual basis to the Interregional Packaging Committee that in its turn then relates all the information back to the authorities. Now, of course, there's money flowing. So what we want to do as well, we talk to the unpackers. The unpackers can be anybody, but just for the sake of simplicity, retail is, for instance, a big part of the unpackers. Okay, so those are the people that get the that receive the packaging from the packaging responsibles. They unpack it, put it on their shelves, and of course the waste is then transported or is being picked up by the waste management companies. If these unpackers do the right thing, and that is do the sorting of their packaging waste in the right streams, they will get incentives from Valipak. This is how the Valipak system works. Some numbers. Last year, we had 750,000 ton, roughly, of one-way commercial industrial packaging put on the market. About 700,000 ton were recycled. So this brings us to recycling, an overall recycling number of 80, almost 90%. Some other numbers, 80% of the wooden packaging materials has been recycled, 100% of the paper, 80% of metal, and roughly 56% of the plastic packaging that's been put on the market is also recycled. What we also know is that 4 out of 5 commercial and industrial packaging on weight basis is reusable. So there's quite a lot of wood that goes into circular systems. So how do we see the circularity? Well, like I said, everything starts with companies that produce packaging materials that is then being sold or is being bought by companies that pack goods. Now what we see, and this is where we're going to put emphasis on these spheres, you will see, there's quite a lot of packaging that does not have recycled content. So this is where we want to start working on. Work with the packing companies to make sure that they accept more packaging materials with recycled companies. Content, excuse me. Then, of course, the loop goes further. Then we have companies that unpack the goods. Let's say, in the example, the retailers. What we see is there's still quite a lot of unsorted waste. So this is where we're going to put more incentives and more actions to make sure that the unpackers will sort their waste much better. Of course, then our friends from the waste management companies, they collect and they start doing some sorting. But what we see as well is that quite a lot of materials goes via traders outside of Europe. Quite a lot of the plastic film is still sent to Asia, where it still has quite some value. So what we are doing here is, like we say in Dutch, and I don't know how to translate this properly in English, meten is weten, so measuring is knowing. It doesn't rhyme as nice. So what we are now setting up is systems so that we can have a better traceability, that we know exactly where all these film bales are going to. Of course, we work very closely together with the recyclers so that the packaging producers can get the right quality of recycled material. And here the circle is then closed.
Two more minutes, Philippe.
Yeah, I'll skip. Okay, good. I'll go a bit faster then. So one of the things that we are then focusing on is we're going to check how far we can go with eco-modulation, so that we give incentives or that we get that the packaging responsibles are paying more in function of the recyclability. We're going to install a bonus malus system to stimulate recycled content. And of course, there is incentives to resolve obstacles in recycled circularity. I'm going to skip this one. What we see today, roughly 40 kilotons per year of LDPE, transport and industrial film, is put on the market and has been collected selectively in Belgium. 60% is still going outside for recycling, but what we see is that the recycled content is only 0 to 5% at best. So what we want to make sure is that we have technical, social, financial, and certification in order to use more LDPE film as tertiary packaging with recycled content. So this gives us a few examples. So we work together, and this is a nice example, Belgium-Netherlands collaboration. Wienerberger is a huge conglomerate of construction products producers. We work together with Rimoplast and with Oerlemans Plastics, and we are proud that we could convince Wienerberger to use shrink hoods to put over their brick pallets containing 50% recycled content. So this is a project that is now running. Everybody was scared about it, but we had independent labs testing road safety, and the road safety tests worked absolutely fine, no issues whatsoever. Once this thing was going, we had the Saint-Gobain group contacting us. This was then the branch Autover, where they hack windows for cars in shrink film that contains as well at least 50%. We're also trying to go to 100% recycled content. So these are a couple of projects that we have finished already with good results. Now we're working on a project which is a bit more ambitious. We go to stretch film with 25% recycled content. Stretch film, as you know, is only 23 microns thick compared to these shrink films, which are typically at least 50, and the Wienerberger was 140 microns. So the challenge there is really. So this is what I wanted to say. So more information you can find on our website. There's also a couple of movies of other companies that have been using the projects that we helped. So I invite you to look at our website.
Thank you. Much appreciated. What's clear from your presentation is that the value actually of the packaging from the commercial and industrial waste is far higher than we might think. So there seems to be a lot of low-hanging fruit there. That's something we have to take into consideration. Thank you very much. Please stop sharing your screen as we will move into our last speaker, which is Vincent Moy from Suez. And I remember Suez as a company which is working at the end of the value chain, waste management, but probably with maybe 200,000 customers, big ones, small ones in, let's say, the Benelux alone. So I think that gives them excellent insight on what's happening in the market with packaging. Vincent, the floor is yours. please unmute. Over to you, Vincent. So at this moment, we can see your screen, Vincent, but we do not hear you yet.
This should do the trick. Really sorry. My mistake.
We made it. The floor is yours, Vincent. Please enlighten us.
Thank you so much. So I'm the manager of Sue Circpack. Sue is probably known to a lot of people, but we are one of the largest waste and recycling companies in the world. We're active in 70 countries. And within Sue, we do a lot of things in the recycling value chain, also for plastics. So we do collection, we do sorting. We have, I think, 20 sorting facilities in Europe. We do reprocessing of PET, HDPE, PP, LDPE. So we have quite some knowledge and experience in the entire value chain of recycling. And we actually turned this into a consultancy service for brand owners, retailers, and packaging companies, where we provide workshops, packaging advice, certification, and also big data on recycling. Going back to basics, because we've had some very nice presentations on chemical recycling and bio-based plastics, etc. But when we look at circularity and even starting with recyclability, not even circular, but recycling, four criteria need to be met. So the materials need to be collected. There needs to be a collection system in place. We should be able to sort it in the right material fraction, and then you need to be able to reprocess the material without there being any hindering or obstructing substances in there. And of course, we need applications. We need markets where we can use the regranulates or the recycled fibers, because otherwise there is no use if there's no market. There already you see a lot of differences, because what is collected in Europe and even beyond Europe, but let's say for Europe, there are huge differences in collection systems. Do you have source separation or not? Is it curbside collection, or you have to bring it somewhere as a resident? Is there a deposit system in place? For what type of packaging is the deposit system running? Some organizations have their own dedicated take-back system. For example, the Nespresso cups, but which percentage of materials do you get back from that? You see often in the B2B that there's return logistics going on. So there are huge differences there. But also what is allowed in these systems? Do they collect flexible plastics? Is there a separate collection of cardboards? And if so, are composites of cardboard and plastics allowed in there? Do you collect beverage cardboards? Can you recycle everything? Is polystyrene accepted or not? In some countries it is. For Germany, France, yes, you can have polystyrene collected and sorted. But in the Netherlands, yes, it's collected, but it's not sorted. So there are huge differences between the member states already. Then going into the sorting, let's assume that it's collected in the mixed collection, the PMD bag, plastics, metals, drinking cardboard, and you start sorting the materials. Then we see, because the technologies that are used for sorting are quite similar throughout the world, basically, but we do see some recurring issues. And I've given you some examples on this picture, which actually ended up most of the times in the residue fraction for us. So we see some, you see the ones from, and it's not naming and shaming, it's just giving you an idea of what it looks like, because I could have mentioned a lot of other brands with the same issues. But we see some of these baking products, so the buttery kind of material, where you have huge sleeves, quite thick sleeves around the bottle, which makes it difficult to identify the material. Probably also some residue, often somewhat more heavy packaging. So that's quite hard to sort out. The one on the right-hand side with the mayonnaise, typically there's a lot of residue in there, so they're too heavy. We try to shoot out, to eject this packaging and sort them in the right material fraction by shooting them out by using air. You can imagine that if you try to blow out something with air, which is really heavy, it will not pass the threshold. So it will not go over the threshold, but will actually fall down too soon, and then it's not sorted correctly. One of the things we found in the analysis of the biggest sorting disasters in the Netherlands was that there were a lot of honey products in there. So plastic packaging with honey is not a good combination for recycling. What happens? A lot of people buy honey. They use some honey, but not all. And because it's standing in the cupboard too long, it will actually start crystallizing. And then people throw it away. But this crystallization means that there's still a lot of residue in there. Again, too heavy to sort. And that's one of the reasons why we see an over-representation of honey products in the residue at the sorting lines. So here you can already see that specific products, like honey, should probably not be put into plastic packaging. But if they were put into glass packaging, it would have been perfectly fine from a recycling perspective. Of course, we have indeed other issues like the life cycle analysis and complete footprint. But from recycling perspective, that would have been much better. So it's also looking at the type of product that you use, what you should do with it. The black packaging, there we typically see that carbon black is used in, but it's used less and less. So there are some good alternatives available on the market for carbon black. But the ones that still did use carbon black were indeed not sorted because infrared cannot detect carbon black. So just to give you some examples of what we occur in the sorting line. Then we go to the next step. Let's assume that everything is sorted correctly. We go to the reprocessing, and there we work with design guidelines, because the design guidelines typically give a good understanding of the issues that we have, which materials are recyclable, which might not be recyclable, but at least will not hinder the recycling of the good material, and which materials are conflicting or actually causing issues for other materials. And this is a very important distinction. I saw in the previous presentation of Esther, you gave the example of this milk bottle where you also want a recyclable sleeve. The current processes do typically not recycle sleeves and labels. They try to get rid of them as much as possible. They might go to another recycler who puts it in a lower grade application. But typically, if something is going to an HDPE or a PP recycler, he will try to get rid of sleeve and label material. So also there, it's good to understand that although the aim of 100% recyclability is of course good, looking just at the laws of physics and at the current installations in place, it's not achievable for now. There are a lot of design guidelines. So we have one, but there are a huge amount. I will show you an ecosystem overview later. But please be aware that they are available. Typically, they will align for 90-95%, and the last couple of percentages becomes interesting, and there I think we should need some more European alignment. This is an example of what this could look like for PET bottles. So it's really not only on the basic bottle, but it's really on the closure system, the label, sleeves, inks, adhesives, direct printing, etc. Really a strong list which will help you to make good decisions for recyclability and circularity. And in the end, after the material has been reprocessed, is there an application? Are we actually sorting to turn it into fuel? Or and is it actually replacing other packaging material or not? Is there a market? For some things, we see that the market in certain countries is just not there. So you can collect it, you can even sort it, but in the end, it ends up at a cement kiln because there is no off-taker who wants to use it as a packaging material or a plastic material again. Yeah. Also looking at the quality of the material, can you typically make the same kind of application from this material? Or is it becoming more of a blend of materials? Or can you only use it in thicker wall products, in compression molding technologies for plastics, for instance? If you can really go from film to film or from bottle to bottle, then we consider it really recycling. In other cases, the materials, although the material is being reused, it's some sort of downcycling. Yeah? Also good to take into account. All these differences throughout the world, we have tried to assess all these differences. What is collected, what is sorted, what are the EPR fees also there, and the rules for extended producer responsibility. Is there a bonus and malus system? Do you get some bonus on your EPR fee if you have a well-designed packaging? All these things we have analyzed. And then it becomes interesting because although this is for us an interesting business model to come up with this information, it's also a bit saddening to see how many initiatives there are. So we have, this is just the ecosystem of recycling initiatives where you see sector organizations, where you see value chain organizations, where you see EPR systems, where you see national bodies that are working on recycling. And we're basically all inventing the wheel on many different places. So design guidelines, I can mention 10 organizations that are working on design guidelines from this group. And I strongly believe that this is not helping brand owners. This is not helping the recycling industry. It's not helping the credibility of recycling. If everybody has a different opinion on this, we should really work together and work on a pan-European standard for not only design for recycling, but also on certification. And it would be great if a lot of these players really align on that. But it's just to give you an idea of what the brand owners have to deal with. Yeah, because what is good in one country cannot be accepted in another country. Well, that's quite weird when you look at the perspective of one European market. For me, that was it. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Very much appreciated to see the practical experience from a company like Suez on what's actually happening in the field, what you encounter. I also took away from your presentation that you should not only look at the goodies, but also like the disturbing factors which can be found, like the sleeves, which is very important when you're designing new packaging. And I think it must be extremely challenging if you're a pan-European producer and you want to bring something on the market, if you have 26 or more EPR systems, lots of different certifications. So quite a challenge. And this is probably bigger than the Belgium and the Netherlands alone, but maybe we can take the initiative there. I want to thank all the four speakers for giving us so much thoughts for, let's say, for discussion. Unfortunately, the time goes fast as well, but we are going ahead with our panel. We have some confrontation, and actually, the first question comes from our Consul General in Antwerp, and Bert van der Lingen. And he says, well, we're here in a cross-border, let's say, webinar. What can we learn from each other? How can we accelerate, let's say, the business over the border? So I want to make a very quick round to each of you, starting with the order of speakers, on how can we work together? What do you see happening in other countries that you think, hey, that can help us as well? How can we find each other? It's a webinar, short answers are appreciated. Carl, first reaction from you, please.
I think there is collaboration already when it comes to mechanical recycling of plastic. So what is recycled in the Netherlands is not recycled in Belgium and vice versa. So we, for instance, export our PET to the Netherlands. And I think the same can happen also in the development of chemical recycling. There's a lot of initiatives, but they probably will all have their own input criteria, all these different installations. And it would be wise to sort of sit together and build a complementary infrastructure for recycling.
Over to Esther, the same question.
Yeah, I think we can really work together, and that is between the Netherlands and Belgium, but also with other countries. There are a lot of initiatives in Europe going on, which we work together across the value chain. A point that we can learn specifically from Belgium, that I was very impressed with, is their collection system. And they have a really high number of the household waste that they can collect and recycle. And also my parents, they live in Belgium, and they are better instructed, I think, than the Dutch people about what can be in the plastic bag or what not.
Thank you for this huge compliment for our Belgium colleagues, Esther. And we move to Philip.
Well, we work as Valipak, we work close together with Netvang. We're also part of IPRO. IPRO is the European Association of Plastics Recycling and Recovery Organizations. So these are basically the EPRs that are working on plastic recovery. So we talk on a regular basis together and see what we can learn from each other. So it's a good example of cross-border knowledge sharing.
Thank you. Last but not least, Vincent, same question, cross-border collaboration.
Well, as you can imagine from the presentation I just did, I don't suggest to go into more design for recycling guidelines. But what I do suggest is that you actually, we know where the issues will be for recycling. So the main challenges will be in the recycling of PET trays and in the flexibles. So if the two countries can really collaborate to make sure that we actually support the development and industrialization and commercialization of that type of recycling facilities, that would be a really step forward.
So very pragmatic work on PET trays and PP and PE flexibles. Okay, we'll pick that up. And anybody from the audience thinks that's interest of them, let's say, let it known through the web chat. We had two special topics. One was chemical recycling. The other was bio-based packaging. Maybe to Carl and Esther, a quick question on chemical recycling. We see it growing fast. It promises to scale up a lot. I make a statement and I ask you to react on it. Chemical recycling should fill the gap between mechanical recycling and incineration. Do you agree with that? Carl, first to you.
Maybe not the gap between, it should fill the gap between the current recycling percentages and the goal that we've put in front of us. And then the residual fraction will still need to be incinerated.
Esther, same question to you.
Yeah, from my point of view, you need chemical recycling and mechanical recycling to come to 100% circular. That's quite a high ambition, and chemical recycling is really needed there. And the question is how much do we need incineration then anymore?
Another question, I stick with this topic and between Carl and Esther. Who should take the lead for scaling up chemical recycling? Is that the waste branch or is that the chemical industry? Carl?
I think it's the chemical industry, but probably we need intermediation there. Last year I was at co-organized an event for the Flemish Dutch Delta, which is a collaboration between provinces and the ports. And I think there's a lot to be done there in collaboration and discussion, rather than building similar installations in this whole region that start competing with each other. The field is broad enough to build a complementary infrastructure.
I feel that this is a topic where we should definitely work on that together. Esther, same for you.
Yeah, as you heard my presentation, you should. I completely agree with Carl, and it should be an complementary infrastructure, and you should think about a systemic approach. What kind of waste is going to what kind of type of recycling? So what is going to mechanical recycling or what's going to chemical recycling?
So there we have to need a systematic approach to bring this further. But to scale up, do you see the initiative in the waste managers or on the chemical industry side?
It could be a combination, I think.
The value chain. Thanks a lot. Vincent, we have been former colleagues, so I feel the freedom that I can put you a little bit under pressure.
Yes, please.
you know that, let's say, the bio-based and especially the biodegradable packaging are a topic of discussion. Yet globally, there is tremendous momentum. If you look at the target for biodegradable packaging that a country like China has, that's incredible. So you see some opposition in the waste branch to biodegradables because it doesn't compost fast enough. Is this something like the taxi branch trying to stop Uber? Or how should we look at it?
I think the issues are very clear. And we can make this compost, but the added value of this material is limited, as pointed out. And you probably need somewhat more spending time in the installations if you really want to compost it or do anaerobic digestion. So it will cost money. For me, it's very clear. If there was a greenfield situation, then bioplastics biodegradable plastics might have been the only thing that we were looking for, but it's not. We have to deal with the installed base that we have. We already have fossil-based non-biodegradable material, and that makes it complicated. We cannot because the amounts that we need are so high that it's difficult to make this step, or impossible even to make this step to all biodegradable materials. So that's really the challenge for me. Besides the fact that, of course, currently when it ends up in the PET stream, you have yellowing effects, agglomeration effects that you don't want in the reprocessing. There are some limitations there.
Clear. Thank you.
May I make a comment on top of that? Do I have time to?
Please, and a short comment, and then you get a short question.
Yeah, good. One of the things I would like to stress is like Karel already said. Basically, we get water and CO2. Actually, composting is basically slow burning. So it takes also the source out of the circularity. So for me, composting is not really the solution. It's more a way of making sure that you don't get too much litter flying around in the oceans, which in the end is also not the idea of compostable plastics. So that's what I wanted to say around this.
Thank you. One question for you, Philippe, and then we go to the web chat. The role of extended producer responsibility in a circular economy. When I look at the presentation of Vincent, let's say I get scared of the amount of initiative and the difference between them. Mm-hmm. Is it obstructing higher recycling rates, or is it a blessing and a motor? How do you look at it from the Valipak perspective?
Well, for us, it's the engine. Because what we see is with the EPRs, we get the measurement, we get the data in. If you don't have a system that measures, we don't know where we're going. First of all, we need to know how much material is being put on the market. And on the other side, we need to know how much waste is being collected. Otherwise, you can't have governments making rules and decisions or getting directions. So for this, I think EPRs is a valuable tool. When you look at Belgium, for instance, if there wouldn't be a FOS Plus, and then I'm talking on behalf of them, if there wouldn't be a FOS Plus, we would not have collective sorting of household waste. It will go all in the same bag, and I don't think that Vincent would like to have to sort the PET bottles from the greens and whatever that's being put in there. It would be just become a mess. So it's one of those things that I think if you don't have EPR, we would not be at the same level of recycling as we are today in Belgium.
Yeah, EPR is the polluter pays principle and making sure that there is actually, let's say, a financing method also to get something done. Vincent, I believe you might have some comments on here. Your name was mentioned.
Of course, the EPR systems have worked to set everything up. But at the same time, when I look at it holistically at the moment, I actually feel that they sometimes can be actually holding back the developments into further recycling. Why? Because the EPR systems typically get paid by the producers, by the brand owners, and the clear goal of a EPR system is to achieve your targets at the lowest cost. Where any company would actually like to overshoot the targets that they have in revenue or profit, there you see that the driver to overshoot your targets for an EPR systems are not there. For instance, in the Netherlands, when you look at the collection of household packaging waste that's subsidized by the EPR system in the Netherlands, works pretty good. At the same time, with that, they reach their targets. And this is why they don't subsidize the collection from the businesses for the same type of packaging waste. And so they could easily go a bit higher in the recycling rates by adding this as well. But it will cost money. That's true.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you for that instance.
That's what we do in Belgium. We have two systems.
This might be an idea. I move over to my colleague Elena, who is managing the web chat. We don't have much time left, but the most pressing or the most interesting question from coming from the web chat. Elena, can you please help us out and post the questions to the panelists?
Yes, hello everybody. Yes, we have quite some good questions almost to all presenters. I think the one should be addressed to everyone is the issue with the migration of the substance of concern into the packaging during the recycling. So what can the presenters say about it? Is it being addressed by the organization that you represent? Is it being how it should be solved? So that was the question that can be addressed. I think it was addressed to almost everyone. And there are some questions to Esther regarding the trends in the Netherlands. What is the progress of the plastic pact and how recycling can be improved to reach the same level as in Belgium? And also what kind of incentives, that's also can be addressed to everyone, incentives that can be used to stimulate the reuse, of the packaging, so to prevent single use plastics use.
Trends, incentives, and the substances of concern. Let's start with the last one. As we are running overtime with our webinar, very short answers, starting in the order of the picture. Carl, Esther, Vincent, Philip.
For substances of concern, it is clear that if we scale up circular economy, that the chemicals content and hazardous materials will be the next topic to tackle, the next problem to tackle. That's and it for me it couples a bit to the to a previous question. That's why I think that safe sinks in the system will remain necessary, and incineration definitely has a role to play there. Otherwise, you will just concentrate hazardous materials in the cycle. And the other question now, I don't remember what I was thinking about.
Well, we move on to the next, yeah. Next speaker, Esther.
So two answers from my side for what can we learn from Belgium for having a better collection system. Well, I think we have to instruct our consumers even better. So how to separate their waste when they have PMB collection systems, when they have to separate, because still a lot of plastics are coming up in the West fraction, which are then immediately incinerated. So, and for the reuse, we have to make it more easy also for the consumer to make it as accessible. So for in the supermarket, this should be people should be able to have reuse packaging. And I know in the plastic packs there are discussions going on how to do that and to start also the first pilots with this one.
Yes, there was definitely a remark in the web chat that the word reuse was not heard enough. And of course, reuse is better than recycling. I'm glad you mentioned it. Vincent, a quick round to you.
Yeah, so health and safety regulation is really important. Not only for recycled material, but also for virgin material, of course. That's why we have REACH in place and other regulation, food grade regulation. EFSA is really looking at that. So I think that will be very important. I think the main challenge is indeed how we can get to food grade qualified material, which is safe to use in food grade applications. I think there that mainly looking at chemical recycling, depolymerization, and seeing how we can get that really accredited as being food grade and really safe. That would be a next step and very important.
I think interesting debate, norm certification, end of waste, and when you're no longer in the waste regiment, you're in the chemical regulation REACH, and that might be even more challenging than we think. Philip, last words from you. Are you still with us, Philip? We see your image frozen. No, then considering...
I froze. Yeah, I'm back. Sorry. Yeah, that's why I think low-hanging fruit, transport packaging, stretch film, shrink films, those kind of things go around the packaging. So there we can put quite a lot of recycled content without having too much. I'm not saying not to worry, but too much to worry about substances of concern. Though we don't like to see them in there, but fine, that's another discussion. The other thing is reusable packaging. Well, people that put reusable packaging in Belgium on the market, they don't have to pay EPR fees. The only thing they have to do is they have to register so that we know how much is being used and that we can see if there is a trend in being more reusable packaging on the market. So in Belgium, it's already taken care of and we are running more projects to help put more reusable packaging on the market.
Thank you very much. I'm afraid that we have come to the end of this this panel session. It's extremely interesting. We could go on with questions at least for another hour. But let me try to wrap up. We have heard some very interesting things and conclusions from Carl that biodegradable plastics are not for throwing away. From Esther, the need for a systematic approach if we want to look better at mechanical versus chemical recycling based on impact resistance. Circular plastics do not stop at the border. We need each other, and certainly we need each other also if you look at the European complexity. And maybe together the Belgium and Netherlands can be leaders in Europe and Europe can be a leader in the world. Philip, you brought definitely in that packaging waste is far more valuable than we think. We have all heard that the role of the designing is I think a very, very, very crucial. Still lots of debates about extended producer responsibility. We can learn from each other. pragmatic way forwards. The PET trace, for instance, the PP and PE flexibles might be just one of the low-hanging fruit. If we can tackle it, we can make a big move as well. And there are lots of developments in chemical recycling and bioplastics where we need each other. Well, the embassy and the consulate have expressed to me that they want to thank all the, let's say, the speakers for their valuable insights. This is something we could, we will continue. And I know that the embassy is offering the embassy for a follow-up session post-COVID to bring further the discussion. So see this as a warming up for future sessions with us all. A big virtual applause to everybody. For all the people present in the webinar, we will send you a link to the webpage with the recording, with the presentations, and keep in touch. If you want a deepening session on one of the topics you heard, please send your last web chat to us saying the next session should be about bioplastics or should be about chemical recycling. If we had at least 10 comments on one of them, we might seriously be triggered to actually go that way. Thanks again. It was great having you over, and see you soon. Bye, everybody.